My name's Sammy Shelor. I'm from Meadows of Dan, Virginia. I'm a banjo player and a hillbilly, and I've been on the road for the past 38 years or so playing bluegrass music. The past 26 years, I've been with Lonesome River Band.
I started coming to the Galax Fiddlers Convention in 1966, and I was 4 years old, and that was my initiation into music. I had family that played, but I really got to hear what old time music was about because my family was more into the bluegrass side of things, and developed a love for old time music, and especially Tommy Gerald and Fred Cockrum. They were my heroes as far as playing old time music. Fred Cockrum was the groovinest banjo player I think that ever lived, and I still listen to that stuff with amazement. But there was just so much music that kind of evolved out of the Galax area over the past 100 years, and I guess we'll kind of start talking about the earlier aspects of it, and we'll let Kilby and Peco kind of demonstrate and talk about their early influences, and y'all take it over there, fellas.
My name's Kilby Spencer. I'm 34 years old, and I'm from White Top, Virginia. I learned to play old time music from my parents, Thornton and Emily Spencer. They have a band called the White Top Mountain Band. The band actually got started back in the 1940s by my uncle Albert Hash. He taught my dad how to play the fiddle, and my dad and mom taught me how to play the fiddle. So that's my musical history.
All right, well, we might play y'all a tune first and then talk a little bit. Maybe a little bit of Backstep Cindy. I'd consider this probably a classic old-time tune from the Galax Mount Area area, and it's real good for dancing, and it's got a good beat to it. You're kind of just setting that beat for the dancers, so maybe we'll try a little bit of that one. Step Back Cindy or Holiding, they called it over around Independence, Virginia. So that some of these tunes might have different names just 15 minutes down the road. That's how it was back then. Tell you a little bit about how I got started playing music, and I learned from my parents, Thornton and Emily Spencer. They've got a band called the White Top Mountain Band, and that band actually started back in the 1940s with my uncle Albert Hash. He was married to my dad's sister, and he was a fiddle maker and luthier from White Top, Virginia. This fiddle that I've got right here was actually made by Albert back in about 1972, and he named all of his fiddles. Lots of them had names like Whispering Hope or Mountain Peace. And this particular one was called the Screaming Witch because it turned out a little different than he thought it would at first. So, but it's mellowed out a little bit since 1972. And I learned from my dad and mom, and they both still play music and are out and about a lot. And also learned from a cousin of mine, Dean Sturgill. He's up in his 80s now, doesn't play anymore, but he was a good fiddle player. And another fella named Johnny Miller, who's a fiddle player from Mount Wilson, Virginia. He doesn't play anymore either, but he was a great musician. He played with Old Bell Reed and was a staff musician up at New River Ranch Sunset Park up north at some of the music parks, and would fill in with groups when they came through back in the 50s and 60s, like Hank Williams, Don Reno, people like that, well-known country and bluegrass musicians. But, you know, old time and bluegrass to me, a lot of people would say my fiddle style is kind of in between the two of them a little bit. And I like both of them equally. And I feel like that style, the kind of in between old time and bluegrass style, probably kind of came about in the 50s and 60s, right after the development of bluegrass, because you had a lot of these old time bands here in the Galax area, especially entering at the convention, and they might want a little extra drive or a little extra punch to compete with the bluegrass band. So they would either have a three-finger banjo in the band for these fiddle tunes, or they might have a clawhammer banjo and two guitars and a mandolin. So I don't think there's that much difference between them. It's just, you know, slightly different techniques. And a story I always think about that my dad told, and I know I saw Ken Landreth out there. He'll appreciate this. There was an old banjo player from Marion, Virginia area named Gaither Farmer. And Dad was playing a show with him when he was like, Dad was 15. He hadn't been playing very long. Somebody came up and said, could you guys do Pike County Breakdown? And he said, oh, wait a minute, I forgot. You play clawhammer. You don't play bluegrass style. That's a bluegrass tune. And Gaither said, well, actually, I do play it because I like it. And he said, I figure if anybody's good enough, if they play clawhammer or bluegrass and they like the tune, they can play it regardless of what their style is. So that's kind of how I think about old-time bluegrass a little bit.
My name is Wayne C. Watson, nicknamed Peco. And the name comes from way back. There's a long story, and I won't tell it. I got started playing music when I was 27 years old, which was a little late, but I just heard the music locally a lot and liked it, and just started trying to learn to play one tune and another tune and another tune, and finally got together with in a band, and we got a band going and played some of the Fiddlers Conventions and so forth. And I've played with several bands since then. And basically, I didn't have any background in music or anything like that. I just had to learn it basically myself from listening to other people play, the old timers play. So that's about my story.
So what was some of your other influences beside Fred and Tommy? Did Kyle kind of get you started, or?
Kyle was a guy, when I went up to buy the banjo, he had another banjo there when I first took mine up there to get worked on. That's when he said, you need a banjo. He picked up one of his banjos. It's a fretless banjo. And I said, my God, Kyle, I can't play one that's got frets on it. Much less one with frets, with no frets. He said, well, I'll have that one next week. But he showed me a little something right there. But when we got the new one, he really made that thing ring. You know, he'd get up on the neck and he said, well, you get up here and you'd be more mellow. You get down here, it's not, you know. And he always used a pick. And I seen that pick and he used, and finally I got a pick that he made, and it's, he made them out of brass. Yeah. And Kyle was, yeah, without a doubt, Kyle Creed was, as far as I'm concerned, best clawhammer banjo picker ever played.
Yeah.
Picked one up, there's no doubt. It's just my style. A lot of people like other people. But,
right.
But anyway. Yes, he was probably, him and Fred Cochran, I'd say, my two favorites.
Well, I had the great fortune of getting to sit. I used to follow Fred and Tommy around the park out here, and just getting to sit and watch the groove that he could portray with his right hand. It was just, I could feel every note he played. But my grandfather played three-finger style and wouldn't let me learn to play clawhammer. He said, no, you're going to stick to that. And it's so opposite of what I do that I had to kind of develop roles to go along with the old-time music. But I've recorded a lot of old-time songs because I love it and love the feel of that stuff. And if old-time, you was talking about the extra drive and stuff, if old-time music is played right, it has twice the drive that bluegrass does. And you can get on this, it's a rhythm train, you know, and it's relentless, it never lets up, and I love playing that music better than anything, you know. I guess a lot of the old time influence I had too was the Shelor family. Jesse and Clara Shelor lived a half a mile from me growing up, and they were part of the Bristol Sessions back in 1927, but they did fiddle and piano, and trying to learn how to play along with those fiddle melodies with the piano, that also created a different kind of role. And so just it all overlaps all the way through, you know. I mean, Bill Monroe started the Bluegrass Boys with String Bean playing banjo. And it wasn't until Earl Scruggs came along that bluegrass was actually defined. And the three-finger roll, to me, is what defined bluegrass music from the old-time string music. Because Monroe was basically just a string band before that, and then it became something, its own entity. And then guys like Ted Lundy and Don Reno, a bunch of great banjo players came along, and Ralph Stanley, and added that three-finger roll to string music and made it a different sound. Y'all got anything else to add about your early influences?
You know, I was thinking I'm going to pass this mic over to Wayne Dye up here, because his dad actually had a band, and Wayne played into the Russell County Boys from over in Russell County, Virginia, of course. And his dad played bluegrass and clawhammer style. And he would switch depending on the song. If, you know, if it's a fiddle tune, he might clawhammer it. And if it's a three-finger, he might do three-finger on it. You got anything you wanted to say about that or tell about it?
I'm Marshall Wayne Dye, Goba Wayne, and I'm from Russell County, a little town called Cleveland, Virginia, Coalfields. I was actually a coal miner. I worked coal mines for 23 years, and had a little accident, had to retire. So, but anyway, I play old-time music and bluegrass and a little bit of country, and but I love old-time music, and I was raised up in a family that played old-time music. So both sides, my mom's side of the family and my dad, played music. So that's how I become, you know, playing music and love it. And so anyway, that's all I do now is play music.
I can play a little bit of everything, banjo, fiddle, piano, and I play a little bit of everything. So, but anyway, like I said, I played with my dad a lot with a band, Russell County Boys. His old-time band, and my dad, he played, you know, like I said, clawhammer or with the picks, and so it was a treat. So, but I'm going to pick you something here. I, like I said, I'm from the coal fields, Russell County, and I grew up, and actually my neighbor used to play for Al Stanley, and he's a cross picker. He cross picked, you know, that's why he picked the guitar, and that's what Ralph liked, cross picking, and but anyway, I'd watch him, and I loved that. I mean, I loved that sound. So I just sort of copied him and picked it up myself and played it. And then I got to actually Bill Napier. He actually played 4 years with a band that I played in right before he passed away of cancer. But Bill, he was actually the first cross picker that ever was. Then George Shuffer come along, and then the others run on down the line. So, but I'm going to pick you something here and cross picking, and hope you like it. Little Rosewood Casket.
That was popularized through Ralph Stanley's music, that style. George really, I mean, he added so much to the Stanley sound with that cross-picking stuff. It was amazing. And George, I guess, 2 years ago, he passed away, 2 or 3 years ago now. And one of the classiest gentleman you ever want to be around. He was just a good guy to visit with, and loved all the musicians and respected them highly. And I had a lot of respect for George, but that kind of changed Ralph Stanley's sound when he introduced the cross picking into the music. Let's see here. So as far as the current old time sound, Kilby, how do you describe the changes from back, you know, when White Top started until now, and what y'all are doing now?
Well, there's several different things go into it. I would say, you know, if you like music, you listen to what's going on around you, and people are constantly creating new things.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing. So you're bound to pick up new stuff through the years as people come up with new techniques and whatnot. I would say one thing, there's a lot better instruments. Everybody's in better tune than they were back then because they didn't have tuners. and I will say this, I feel like old-time music, so Peco and Wayne and I play with the Crooked Road Ramblers. If we do a lot of shows, if we just got up here and just did fiddle tunes and banjo, just instrumental music, people don't enjoy that 3 hours of nothing but instrumental music. So a lot of the old-time bands these days, I'd say we work up different songs, maybe throw in some bluegrass or some country. You know, they're all cousins or very closely related. So I would say that's one of the big differences through the years is if you perform an old-time music in public and you're doing a show, you're going to want to add a little bit of variety, and it's just natural to do some of that, do some different kinds of material from other genres. So that's the way I would describe maybe some of the ways it's changed through the years if you're a performing old-time band, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's move on to kind of the progression of bluegrass through the Galax era and area. And also, when I was growing up in it, I would listen to Bill Monroe's music, and I'd listen to Flatten Scruggs music. But when I would get out at Galax and start listening to Ted Lundy and like Cullen Galyon and guys like that from this area, I heard a little different sound from what I was hearing from Monroe and Flatten Scruggs. Scruggs had that feel about him, and something about Western North Carolina, Western Virginia, East Kentucky, and East Tennessee. This four-state area in the mountains, the Appalachia bluegrass sound, is different from what you hear that came out of Western Kentucky or Western Tennessee or any other area. It just seems like, and when I started really noticing it was with Boone Creek. That's where, with Wes Golden playing rhythm guitar, there was a different feel totally, and that's kind of what drew me in. That and J.D. Crow and New South, that second generation of bluegrass players, is kind of what drew me into it. I'll introduce Bobby Lundy, who is one of the finest banjo players I've ever known, and we've been friends for years, and he had such a great influence growing up in the household he did, and with the family that he did. His whole family's just so music oriented. The Goldens, the Lundys, I mean, just everything he was exposed to. And he can kind of maybe lead you through the progression of what he saw.
Well, my name's Bobby Lundy, and I'm from Newark, Delaware. And my dad was Ted Lundy, which he grew up down here in Galax, and that's pretty much where I learned how to play, was down here in the park, listening to music and just trying to learn how to play. And you know, being up in Delaware, you don't have the old time music up there like you do down here. It's more bluegrass. So that's where the bluegrass come from, but I love the old time.
Well, see, you guys were lucky, man, because I'm from Delaware, so only time I really got to hear the real deal was when I'd come down here. And so the only thing I had to work out was what my dad was playing. And, you know, of course he loved old time, but he played bluegrass, but he, I don't know, his his backup, I guess, more so than playing the tune itself. I think that's where that sound, that roll, was different than Earl Scruggs. I mean, he loved Earl, but I loved what he said. He says, you know, you can't beat a man at his own game, so don't Absolutely. Even try. Make it your own.
Yep.
And while it could be good, it could be bad. It depends on if you learned it right or wrong. But he loved old time, and so do I. And he would try to, like Sammy was doing earlier, and they like take the three-finger style and try to play an old-time tune and keep it within that sound, but getting a roll to fit. And it's different, ain't it? It's because it's so, I don't know, it's rhythmic. The clawhammer is so much rhythm within the lead playing, where you got more single strings in the picking. So I, you know, Dad, he just listened to that stuff, and I'll play a little bit of Sally Ann is where I got it from Dad, and he just, you know, did the double C tuning, and that's what it came up with. Y'all can play along with me if you want.
Perfect example of the crossover between the two. And like you say, Ted grew up around Fred and Kyle and all those guys. And, you know, and I was the next generation of that coming up that kind of tried to grab what we could from that feel and add it to bluegrass music. And it seems like the tunes I've recorded over the years, the old time tunes get more attention than anything else I try to do.
Well, Sam, you know, being out on the festival circuit, you know, you when it comes time for the banjo picker to feature the banjo player to do a tune, you know, I mean, they're doing Lonesome Red Blues and stuff like that. Well, you know, like Sally Ann, there ain't nobody plays a bluegrass style. So it's a bonus for me because how many times you want to hear Lonesome Red Blues by a banjo picker?
Yeah.
So I can, you know, that's one advantage I had. I could take that tune right there, and nobody was playing it on the bluegrass circuit. Where in old time, that's pretty much a standard.
Yeah.
You know? But then with bluegrass and old time, where bluegrass, you know, you have turnarounds, you have backup, you have kickoffs, and so it's like just a piece of the song. It ain't fiddle tunes, and then you have like slow stuff, but most of the slow stuff I play is singing, so I'm just kicking it off or taking a break. But I'll just play a little bit of like a slow thing that it's more like a two finger thing, and it's a tune, it's a singing song, it's called Prison Walls of Love, but the here's the break to it, and it's kind of the difference, you know, like with bluegrass being like slow stuff. Where if you had the whole band with you, it's
and what you're basically doing is emulating steel guitar licks,
yeah.
But you don't have the sustain of the steel guitar, so you have to keep a roll going, but accent the melody notes,
right,
of what the steel guitar would be playing in his sustain world.
Right, it's a shame we can't get that sustain.
I know. But I was, I've always been a huge fan of Bobby's music, and the years he played with Bob and Danny Paisley, to me that was one of the premier traditional bands that ever toured out here, and it vocally, everything involved, and he's talking about playing backup behind a vocalist, you know. Your job is to get the song started, and then when that vocalist comes in, you don't want to be noticed anymore.
Right.
So you end up doing just more of a... And then when the vocalist takes a breath, that's when you want to fill that hole. So you got like two or three beats that you're going to put a lick in. So you accent that, and then you back out again. And just keeping that rhythm going behind that vocal. And because it's that a lot of, when I do workshops and so forth, the one thing I talk to players about more than anything is being a part of a band.
Right.
Because when you're sitting at the house playing by yourself, you don't understand what goes on. And when you're out jamming at a fiddler's convention or a festival or wherever, if you can't hear the featured instrument, you're probably playing too loud,
right,
as a banjo player.
Or playing too much.
Yeah, or playing too much, yep. So learning to be able to play with the same intensity at this volume or that volume. Because if you're standing in a circle and a guitar player is taking a break, that's how quiet you got to play to be able to hear the notes he's playing. And to be able to play with that, you know, be able to get the dynamics into it and complement what's going on, not destroy it.
And the thing is, you know, people say, well, what are you doing? And really, backup, you ain't doing nothing.
Mm.
It's just a roll, just trying to...
You're a rhythm instrument.
Yeah, it's just a rhythm, but there's no melody to it, so it's hard to teach somebody rhythm. You know, it just, like I say, I don't know what I'm doing most of the time. Especially if I'm singing on a chorus or something, I'm playing, I don't have a clue what I'm doing now because I'm concentrating on my singing. So with the banjo, it's just making a noise to me.
Yeah.
Just keeping the rhythm going, like you said.
And I describe a bluegrass band as five people being, thinking like a drummer, because you got the bass doing the kick drum, you got the mandolin chop doing the snare drum, you got the guitar playing the hi-hat, and the banjo is playing basically what the hi-hat would do. But you have to have those four things thinking as one in order to sound like a band. And everybody has to have the same concept of timing and feel it the same way, because if one little thing is out of kilter when you're playing at 130 beats a minute, it's the train's going to derail.
Yeah.
And but just complimenting and being a rhythm instrument when you're not, and you, because you have to fill that hole because you don't have the drums,
right,
filling that,
right.
So every instrument is filling that, those gaps in between, and between the downbeat and the upbeat, there's a lot that goes on in that little short space of time. And the rhythm guitar is filling that, and the banjo is filling that.
And you know, it's funny because like you're saying, with a band, you get that sound, that band sound, and then you go out and somebody wants you to fill in, and you play with another band. It's like, what you play with that band does not work with the band that you're playing with. So you just got to rethink of your playing, what can I do to make it the band sound? And sometimes you can, sometimes it won't work. It just, you know, because you don't play with them enough. So you're just a fill-in, and that's basically what it sounds like sometimes.
Exactly.
Unless you can find what they're doing and adapt to that. But just to jump in with different bands, it's hard.
It is. And just finding your place within that rhythmic groove.
Right. And yeah, it's all in the rhythm.
What's a good A tune, or wherever y'all want to go, we can go to D too, that we can all play together. You spend more time tuning a banjo than you do playing
it.
That's they always say you spend 75% of your time playing, tuning the banjo, and 25% playing out of tune. So.
One thing I would observe about the kind of role that Sammy and Bobby do is it's very danceable. It's possible that some forms of bluegrass, like you're saying, from different areas, it's not always an emphasis on the dance beat. But that particular role right there, anybody could dance to that. It makes you want to dance.
It comes from the old time influence for sure, because and Bobby's dad was one of the masters of that. And just playing a lot off the downbeat, you know, pushing the downbeat, because that's what the dancers are listening for. And I grew up playing square dances, and all the dancers when I was a teenager, you know, they would always tell me, keep that banjo in the microphone, because that's what we're playing off of. Because the dancers are doing they're playing off the 16th notes, and that's exactly what the banjo. They're dancing the same thing that the banjo is rolling. Yeah. I guess, you know, with Bill Monroe coming along in 1942, 43, on through to about 1948, that was kind of the formative years of Bill Monroe's music. And bluegrass, Joe Wilson always said that bluegrass evolved from the invention of the microphone, because when Bill Monroe brought the music to the Grand Ole Opry, he started featuring soloists, which string music before was pretty much like these guys. They're playing that melody, and the rhythm is doing its thing. The banjo and the fiddle are hammering that melody and driving that dance feel. And until Munro came along, it really wasn't a lot of featuring different soloists. Munro would kick a song off on the mandolin, or Scruggs would kick a song off on the banjo, or the fiddle would kick a song off, and then there would be a vocal verse, a chorus with harmony, and then somebody would take a solo break with the rhythm instruments backing them up, and they would play the melody that the singer just sang. Or if they're kicking a song off, they're establishing the melody of that song before the singer ever starts singing it. A friend of mine in Bristol, Tennessee, Kenny Morrell, he's a fiddle player and just a very knowledgeable gentleman on the history of our music and who played what, and he's a huge Chubby Wise fan. I mean, he loved everything Chubby ever did. And he was listening to the Grand Ole Opry the very first night Earl Scruggs debuted with Bill Munro. And the first song they came out and did, Earl kicked it off. And he said when he heard Earl playing, he heard the words in the banjo. And it was Molly and Tim Brooks. And and he said as soon as Earl kicked into that dun, 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 he knew exactly what song Bill was going to sing. And people ask me how I learned this lick or that lick. It's from listening to a singer, because every time you learn a new song, there's a new line in that song that the singer sings that you've never played on a banjo before. So you got to learn where that melody is. And I sit and listen to them sing it through, and I just visualize on the fingerboard where each one of those notes is. But then I got to figure out how to get them into a roll and accent those notes and make them work. So that was kind of the evolution of bluegrass, was having that microphone to where each person could stand up, stand forward, do their solos, the vocalist does his thing, the trio did their thing, and then the next soloist would stand up. There was just, it kind of added theatrics to it as well, because there was movement on stage all the time. You know, before the string bands would kind of huddle around that mic and everybody would get, you know, they would just play that melody and hammer that rhythm. But Munro added theatrics to it and gave it a visual effect. And as he started touring, you know, back in those days they had one microphone and that was it. And I talked to Jody Rainwater many, many times. He was eventually became the bass player and one of the comedians in the Flat and Scruggs show, but he started out as a booking agent. And his job as a booking agent back in those days was leave Nashville on Monday morning and pick a direction, drive to five towns, find a drive-in theater or a school that he could get on whatever night was available, and put up posters, go to the radio stations, do all that. He would go book five towns in one day and then drive back to Nashville and tell the band where they were playing that week. And they all had to be within a certain radius of Nashville, because they had to be back every morning at 5:45 to do a radio show. So they would go play their gig, drive all night, come back in and do the radio show, and then go to bed. And if you ever hear recordings, and you can find them, of the Martha White radio show, and listen to Flat and Scruggs at 5:40 and at 5 in the morning playing and singing at the rate and the range that they did, you knew they stayed up all night, because there wasn't no way they were going to get up at 5 o'clock and be able to sing like that, you know. And but that was just how the business was done in those days. And but when they would play these schools, they'd have one microphone. When they'd play the drive-in theater, they'd put a microphone on top of the concession stand. People would pay extra to come in early, drive up to the parking spot, get the car speaker and hang it in the window, and they watched the show and listened to it on the speaker in their car. And that was high fidelity in those days. You want us to play some more?
Please.
All right. Well, I'm talking too much. Let's do kind of a more modern bluegrass thing. Get Billy and I don't know what to do. I'm at a loss. We'll do a round kind of featuring solos, and we'll do Bill Cheatham and just everybody, and it just kind of demonstrate what we do when we're not playing. Any questions out there? What's that? This is Billy Hawks right here. And Billy's from... Billy traveled the roads with Junior Sisk and Rambler's Choice for quite a while, and a great fiddle player. And you play one of Glenn's fiddles? Mm-hmm. This fiddle here, he was talking about Albert Hash there earlier, one of the great instrument builders of this area, and this is built by a guy that I played in a band with back in the 70s when we were teenagers, and he's become a new generation of fiddle makers in this area. His name's Glenn Boyd, and he's building some great stuff and showcasing local luthier talent in this area.
Hello, my name is Billy Hawks. I'm from Dobson, North Carolina. Started playing music when I was around 9 years old, which was the guitar at that time. And then I heard, like I said earlier in the show we did, heard Ricky Skaggs' song, Crying My Heart Out Over You, with Bobby Hicks playing that background fiddle. And I thought, that's kind of what I want to do. So I got a fiddle, and here I am.
Billy Hawks is my name. Mr. Spencer indicated, the difference between bluegrass and old time, I'm right in the middle as well. I really grew up playing old time music, or around old time music. So I learned from Rafe Brady. He was a local there around home, and he's the one that, what little bit I was shown, he showed me what little bit I did know, but just watching mostly. So I miss Rafe. He was a good fiddle. You played a lot with Rafe, mm-hmm. growing up, so. Around Benton flipping a lot. We used to jam at the house about every night and go coon hunting afterwards and come back and play some more. So, but I was lucky and grew up in a house playing music too. My mother, she took guitar lessons at a local college, and I couldn't join the class, but I could go. So I'd go with her. When we'd get home, she'd say, "What did we learn tonight?" So I would show it to her. So I actually started out playing the guitar. What'd be another good tune we could all play together?
That's what I was trying to think of here.
Yeah, I play some.
I don't know if y'all noticed, but he's got four strings on his fiddle, and he has five on his.
Yeah, this one comes with a low C string, which is actually the first string off of viola. I think Bobby Hicks, I guess, would he be the one that?
Yeah, Bobby kind of popularized five string in bluegrass.
Yeah, and when he was playing with Skaggs, he used a five string fiddle a lot, so I heard it and I wanted one. Actually, that's what got me started playing the fiddle, was him playing the backup parts he did on Crying My Heart Out Over You with Skaggs. That's what, doing like Sammy was talking about, emphasizing what the singer's doing. That's what the fiddle player tries to do too, and I call it question and answer. They'll ask a question and you answer it with a fiddle.
Yeah.
And try never to play over the top of a vocal singer, because you're just there to make them sound better. You come up with anything?
Well, and two, the fiddle has a lot of the same voicing as a vocal. And it has a sustain that the banjo doesn't have. And there's certain fiddle players that can play behind a vocalist and play phrases while the singer's singing and stay out of the way, and then there's some that can't. But Tommy Jackson was the master of being able to just play a line behind a vocal that totally had nothing to do with what the singer was singing, but it worked and it made sense. And there's so many fine nuances and to the art of playing behind singers, and that's what we all strive for as a band player. Well, we'll try to do you one more jam tune here, I guess, but we've had a great time with y'all, and she won't talk. I'd like to get her to talk. That's the very talented Grace Wilson back there on bass.
Well, my name's Grace Wilson, and I'm from right here in Galax. And I started playing the fiddle, actually, when I was about 7, I think. And then I played that for a while with some kids just from around this area. And then I switched to the bass. I think I was 11, something like that, and I started playing with the band that I still play with today. But I grew up, my dad played, my grandpa played, I grew up around music a lot, and I don't know, I've always loved it, and they kind of just put it on me, and I just kind of picked it up listening to them play.
And I had the pleasure of getting to produce a couple of albums with the band she works with, Loose Strings, and enjoyed being around those folks and talented people, and she's a great bass player. And for me, if you don't have the bass going, it makes it hard to play. Yeah. Say again. Sing something.
I'm not a singer.
I can't sing.
Right. Here's my. This is
That's right. Here. This is my voice.
Yeah.
Let's jam on another fiddle thing.
A little bit John Brown's Dream.
We all do.
John Brown's Dream.
What
do
you
play
silly?
Oh, okay. I don't care whatever you want.
Yeah,
I do. Yeah, man. I like it.
Which one?
John Brown's Dream.
Yeah.
Yeah.
John Brown's Dream?
Yeah, man. Thank y'all so much. Appreciate y'all being with us.